something there, the feeling someone isn't being honest with you.
Yep, so how do you know who's telling the truth and who's maybe weaving a web of lies? Well, body language expert Janine Driver isn't called the lion tamer for nothing. She's here to help us with our lion today. Good to see you again, Janine.
Nice to see you guys.
Good. So this is not, it doesn't seem to be an exact science, is it, determining when somebody's lying? But there are cues that if we're astute, we can pick up on things.
Well, it's pretty complicated. We always think, you know, your mom, when we were little kids, would say, look at me in the eyes when I'm talking to you.
Yeah.
It's not that easy. Or your nose will grow, you know? I mean, it's not that easy. I worked with the law enforcement agency, ATF, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, mm-hmm. for 16 years as an investigator. And that's where I really mastered the trade of understanding body language and how to tell someone's lying.
Short of a lie detector test, right?
Yes, yeah. Actually, I think that the human mind and eyes are actually better than a lie detector test.
Really?
Well, this is my job, is to actually get you to confess. It's not just to notice that you could potentially be deceptive, but to notice it and then ask a powerful question.
So even if I'm saying something to you, you're watching my body language, my eyes, where my hands are,
yes.
how comfortable I am. So it doesn't matter what I'm saying, it's
right.
how I'm saying it.
Exactly. So I'm always getting your baseline. What is your baseline behavior? And then I'm looking for changing your baseline. And that includes word choices.
Okay.
You know, I had a person just stay, a former employee of mine, asked if her boyfriend could stay at our house. We have a downstairs guest suite, and it has its own side entrance. I said, sure, and he was staying there for the whole summer, for a couple months, right? We go to Maine for a week. I come home, and someone has been sleeping in my husband and I, our bed.
It's like Goldilocks.
Someone ate our steaks. All the steaks were gone. My husband's like,
and my chair was broken.
And someone, I'm like, and someone's still sleeping in my bed. Well, when I confronted my former employee on it, she said this: I would never sleep in your bed. You were my boss. That would be strange. I never slept in my parents' bed. That would be weird. So I would never sleep in your bed. Where's the lie?
Did you buy it when she was saying that to you?
No, because this is why. What's the correct answer? I did not sleep in your bed.
Yeah.
She's saying, I would not. That's about a future event.
Oh.
We often get snowballed by people's words, too. You know, I would not do that. We remember Susan Smith in the 90s.
Yeah, the one that drove the kids in the car into the lake.
She was going through a divorce, separated. The boyfriend didn't want to date a girl with kids. He dumped her. So she thought, oh, I think I'll kill my kids in a car. And she drowned her kids. And she said, a black guy came, took the car, and took the kids. And then she said, I loved my children.
Past tense.
Past tense. With who else? We have JonBenet Ramsey. Remember Mark Carr came out? Mark Carr was the guy who had like no hair on his arms. He was the guy that said he was there when JonBenet was murdered.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he said, I love JonBenet. What's wrong with that?
She's dead.
She's been dead for a decade, for the love of God, you know? So he's like delusional. I love her. That's in the current tense. That tells us that there's some mental illness there.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking for the verbal indicators and nonverbal indicators.
And they have to match, don't they?
They do. They need to match. You know,
the big same one goes for gestures have to match.
Yeah, absolutely.
The emotion.
The gestures have to match emotion. So if I say I'm very devastated, there's a guy named Neil Entwistle. Neil Entwistle murdered his wife and 9-month-old baby while they were snuggling in bed together.
Wow.
He shot them both with a shotgun in Massachusetts. As the show the video of the actual crime scene, the dead wife and dead baby, and the baby bled to death. The mother died right away. They're showing the footage in court. What is he doing? He's doing that. And you can see the corner of his mouth is actually smiling.
Oh, God.
In true sadness, our eyebrows are pulled together and pulled up.
Brown, yeah.
Yeah, you want to see true sadness? All people have to do, America, go back and look at Paris Hilton when she was rearrested. Remember, they arrested her, and then they said, well, you can do a house arrest.
Tell, yeah.
Yeah, and then they're like, the judge is like, I don't think so. You're going back to the can. You can see Paris Hilton's eyebrows pulled together and pulled up. That's true fear and anger and sadness.
And what about
sadness.
Lindsay Lohan in court when she found out she was going to be hauled off to
jail? Yeah.
Her face just told the whole story,
acting,
didn't it?
It's genuine, right? So when you have smiling where you're watching something terrible, that's what's called duping delight. It's as if I'm saying, ha-ha, I got away with something. When you confront your boyfriend, you say, who's Michelle? I found this business card in your pocket. Who's Michelle,
exactly.
Your fiance? And he goes, what? Natasha, I love you. That little gilly.
Stalling.
Yeah, that stalling technique. I'd have to be stupid to cheat on you. What kind of person do you think I am? You're looking for a change in the behavior, any of those stalling techniques. And here's a good one that I love about liars. Liars will face you like this, Mel, but they'll suddenly turn their belly button. So Janine, did you steal $1,000 out of my purse earlier? And I'll say, Mel, what kind of person do you think I am? I'd have to be stupid to do something like that. My belly button faces the direction I want to head.
Do you think that's always happening with people? I could see people get defensive. Say if they really didn't do it and you're being called out, you would do
this. Well, I say this.
But you think the moving.
Well, first
really
of all,
deep.
I love that you did that. It's the belly button faces the direction. But I say you have 3 strikes and then you're out. Did you steal my money? What kind of person do you think I am? Because I'm attacking your character maybe first.
Uh-huh.
Did you steal my my money. I'd have to be stupid to do that. Janine, you're the lion tamer. You wrote this fancy book. Did you steal my money? No. As long as you give me a no in the first three tries that I ask you, the first time, three, then I have an 85% accuracy rate that you're telling me the truth.
But if you're answering a question with a question, that's the tip-off, right?
Well, it's possible. With deception, you want to look for three things. So three things, whether they're verbal or nonverbal. We're looking at A-Rod. When A-Rod was being interviewed a year before he came clean that he took steroids, he was being interviewed by Katie Couric. Do you remember?
Yeah.
It was a big thing, and he said this, I did not take steroids. I never cheated.
Did he not realize that he was giving it away with himself?
But then he also did this. He did a shoulder shrug. A shoulder shrug tends to be uncertainty. What do you want for lunch? McDonald's, Burger King, want to make something healthy? I don't know. That belongs there. I'm a Republican. I say I'm a Republican, I shoulder shrug, then I'm not probably a Republican. I think people should be able to smoke in bars. And they do that. That's uncertainty. So when I'm making a definitive statement with my language, but I do this shoulder shrug, it's called an emblem. An emblem is anything that has a common meaning. This is okay here, but in Puerto Rico, you do this and you'll get a couple guys' phone numbers. So these emblems are territorial.
So one shoulder is uncertainty,
both.
And two shoulders is definitely not?
Just any kind
yeah,
of,
they're both.
It just shows lack of confidence.
It's just, yeah, it just says I'm not sure. And sometimes you can get a hand shrug. A hand shrug is this. Hey, Janine, would you like to come back after the commercial break? Sure. You could simply say this, maybe I'm wrong here, it seems like you're uncertain. And I can say, well, when's the commercial break? It's all about noticing the behavior and asking that question. Maybe I'm wrong here. For people at home, write it down. Maybe I'm wrong here. It seems to me that you're finding humor in this. You're fired. I fire you from your job and you smile. Why are you smiling? Are you gonna come back and kill us all? Are you sabotaging the show?
We happen to be a flight attendant. We're gonna stop right there. We're gonna talk a little bit more with Janine after the break.
Ooh.
Maybe we can talk more
Sounds
about
good.
Men. You gonna be here or not?
Yeah.
What's in my brain? Cause your curiosity make you insane.
And we are back with round two with the Lion Tamer. Janine Driver is helping us with our body language. And you were just telling me, Janine, that you were out in Vegas teaching a large group of police officers
yes.
how to tell if people are lying.
Yeah, just in Las Vegas. I came back 2 days ago teaching 650 law enforcement officers how to tell people are lying. My clients, I've trained the CIA, the FBI, Scotland Yard Police, and you'd be surprised. You never know. If you sat next to me in a bus, you wouldn't say, I bet you she could bust me in a lie. Ruin this whole affair.
We know different. Well, you know, you think about getting a third degree, which police officers would give a perp, right?
Yeah.
And they're sitting in there with the lights on them, and they're sweating, and they're fidgeting. I mean, those
are It's just like in the movies, right?
Well,
the
old days.
And,
in the old days, they used to have the good cop, bad cop, and the bad cop would come in, and we know you're selling guns, Natasha. We're on to you. And, but the problem is with that approach is when you come in aggressive, you don't know if the signs they're exhibiting with stress are related to you intimidating them or because they're holding something back. So I actually talk about being their friend, being their best friend first, and getting to know them, sometimes not even talking about the crime. They like to flip houses, talking about that first before you get into the heavy duty stuff.
Break down their defenses that way?
Yeah, well, you want to get their baseline. What is someone's
their trust,
normal behavior?
Maybe a little bit?
Well, for instance, like sometimes when people lie, they'll bite their lip or they'll touch their face or rub their throat. So when people bite their lip, touch their face, you've got this person right here biting their lip. This
In case you didn't know what biting your lip means, we've got a picture of it.
we really kick it up a notch here.
Yeah, we do.
So what happens is that's called a pacifier or manipulator, and those increase in stress. Well, sometimes people are fidgety, right?
Yep.
So you have to look at what's their baseline first. I'm very fidgety. I move a mile a minute. I'm always adjusting my clothes, my bra strap. What is my baseline? If all of a sudden it increases, you know there's an increase in stress there. So all of a sudden I start rubbing my neck or I touch my eyes. Oftentimes people touch their eyes with deception. Britney Spears, and Britney Spears was pregnant with her second baby,
she
remember?
Did that interview and
Who,
she
her boobs were hanging
stretching.
Out,
yeah.
Eyelashes were falling off, it's chewing gums,
yeah.
We drop our babies, we're country, right? Matt Lauer holds up this rag mag and says, look, it says that Kevin's sleeping in the basement in this magazine, is that true? And Britney takes her hand and rubs down to her knee. And then all of a sudden, Matt Lauer goes, and Char, who he was dating before you, was pregnant with her second baby when he left her for you, like all this drama. Don't you believe in karma? And Britney takes two hands, rubs down to her ankle and back up. These are pacifiers and manipulators. They
you know,
increase.
You talk about the rubbing, but what about everybody? There's a lot of people that bite their nails, and they bite it out of boredom, out of habit.
Right.
Is it always
That's why you need the baseline, Natasha. No, you need that baseline. What is their baseline? Do they touch their nails? Does their foot? I had an intern, Jake, who moved his foot 100 miles a minute. You know, I used to do that when I was a kid, and at church, my mother, the pew would be moving at church, and my mother would grab me and she'd say, "For the love of God, stop moving your foot." What is someone's baseline behavior?
I thought that was a sign of boredom. The faster you...
If all of a sudden it pops
just
up.
Caffeine.
No, it could just be someone's behavior. So if all of a sudden they're calm, both feet are on the ground, then they start doing it. Maybe it's boredom. Maybe they want to be someplace else. Maybe they have to go to the restroom. Notice a change in behavior. Here's one of my favorite questions. Is there any reason why you suddenly became super confident, Natasha? Do you see at home? She just popped. I love this move.
Just chilling.
This is the diva sex appeal move, by the way.
What is it?
She popped it.
I gotta do it more often.
She popped the elbow back. It's confident. You're opening up your three power zones right
here. I want to make sure my belly button's facing you. I didn't want you to call me out.
Smoking hot. This is very powerful. But liars try to convince us of something where innocent people try to convey. If you remember, Roger Clemens was up on the Hill, and people are still debating whether he was lying or not.
Uh-huh.
Well, you have Brian McNamee, his personal trainer. He looks like a wet rag. Brian McNamee is like this. This is what people look like when they're confessing, when they're giving it up.
Defeated.
Typically, when people try to convince us of something, the people who are holding something back, they get bigger. They take up more space.
Mm-hmm.
You call me a liar, and they take up more space. And this is something we need to look for. Also, with a tone of voice change. 85% of people who lie, there's a change of their tone of voice.
Mm.
When Jennifer Aniston was dating, what's the big tall guy?
He's the funny guy.
No, the funny guy.
Vince Vaughn. Yeah.
She was on Oprah, and she said, "No, we're still together." And her tone of voice went down. Well, when our voice goes down, that's sadness. If you're still together, why is that sadness? You should just simply say, Oprah could have said, "Well, is there any reason why you're sad when you say that?"
Mm-hmm.
And then you find out, is the lie there or not? Whatever the answer is, say Jennifer Aniston said, "Well, it's just that the press is really giving us a hard time." The next question, this is great, America, listen. If you think someone is lying,
America,
you must listen. You simply, after they give the answer, say, "Really?" I was on Donnie Deutsch with The Big Idea. Do you know Donnie Deutsch?
What, like you don't believe them? Like, really?
Yeah. So we did a game, Two Truths and a Lie. We'll have to come back and we'll do this together. I'll have you each lie and tell me the truth, and I'll see if I can find which is the lie and which is the truth. So I said, Donnie Deutsch told two truths and a lie. And the one that was the lie, he had a verbal slip-up. He said the nicest thing he ever did for someone was he got a loan, I mean, bought a scholarship for his maid son so the maid could go, so she could go to college. Made son so she could go to college. And then he goes, "I mean, so he could go to college."
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as he messed up, so when someone messes up, all I said was this. I go, "Really?"
Oh. Call him out on it.
And then I call it wait, WAIT, which stands for why am I talking? Wait it out. Say really and zip it. Really, Natasha.
Because a lot of times you need to listen.
Yeah.
It's not a matter of like questioning, it's listening, right?
It's listening with your eyes. This is called our visual information channel. Any information we're taking in with our eyes. So I'm listening with my eyes, paying attention to the word choices. Are you saying word choices like we talked about in the last segment? I would never do something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Did you cheat on me? I would never do something like that. I'm saying a past event.
No, you didn't answer the question.
If the answer should be no, I didn't cheat on you.
Oh, if somebody takes a long time to answer, like you said that Britney Spears was listening to Matt Lauer's question, then she rubs her legs. Is she buying herself some time to kind of craft the story? I mean, does that happen sometimes?
Well, in high stress, what we do is we'll often move our body. We'll take a glass of water. We'll rub ourselves. It's as if we're saying, "It's okay, I'll get through it. It's okay, I'll get through it."
Mm-hmm.
When I bring someone up in front of my class, I do classes around the country as a keynote speaker, and they don't want to be up in front. You'll often see the person doing this, and I'll say, "You don't want to be up here, do you?" And they'll say, "No." So it is. It's a comforting gesture. When we do those pauses.
But the consistency factor is important, too. Getting the story right and repeating it.
Absolutely. Well, you're looking for pauses that don't belong or pauses that shouldn't be there. What did you wear last Wednesday? There should be a pause there, because if she told me it was a black dress, I would say, "Is there any reason why you know it was a black dress?" It was my birthday, and I remember I wore my black dress because my husband likes a black dress.
So last word, watch and learn. We've got to stop there.
That's it.
We gotta go.
That's it.
These are good hints. Janine Driver, good to have you here.
Nice
to
be back.
Have you. Thank you. Okay.